Thank you so very much for coming, Aparnadi, for coming all the way from Calcutta with your hurt knee. So it's absolutely fantastic to have you here. Shall we go ahead? So one of the things of having both of them here together that we found so interesting, and perhaps we could start talking from that point of view, is both of them have started as actors. And have gone on to direct. Konkana has just done a wonderful first film, Death in the Ganj. If you haven't seen it, see it. It's lovely. And Aparnadi, you started as a director at a time when there were really weren't very many women directing. Was there anyone else?
Well, there was Sai Paranjpe was there. Vijay Mehta was there.
on screen?
Yeah, she was there in Bombay. In Calcutta, there had been a lady long before me, you know. Okay. She was also an actress who became a director.
So what made you take that journey from acting to directing?
Well, you know, the thing is that I really had wanted to be an actor. Even at the age of 10, when I'd done a play in school, I had enjoyed it so much. This was Shrutajit Rai's father. He'd written a book called Hojo Borola, which is a kind of nonsense thing, Shukumar Roy. And we, very well-known book. Which I used to tape for Konkana when she was small and leave it behind for her. Anyway, so I was playing Ami, which is me, the first person character. Now they made me wear a red sari as a dhoti and turn me into a little boy. Today I would have questioned why a little boy. Ami could very well have been a little girl. But then I was not at the age when one questioned at that time. So anyway, I went along. But you know, the funny thing is that right from the time that I entered through one wings and left, I think, by the other, at the end of the play, because I was there all through, I found that I'd not enjoyed anything as much. I mean, nothing till then. Studies, drawing, painting, dancing, singing, games, nothing had engaged me so much. I was in a trance. And the next morning, while brushing my teeth, I told my parents that I was going to be an actor. Yeah. And my parents were the sweetest. I was their first child, so they were quite young. And they said, yes, you know, when you're older, we are going to put you in the Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts, RADA. So I said, fine, that would be wonderful. Mm-hmm. By the time I was about 13, I'd realized that that wouldn't do. Very, very precautious. But I came and told my parents, you know, if I go there and learn, there won't be roles for Asians. So I'll just have to, if I have to act here, I'll have to come and unlearn everything. So they said, that's true. Okay. We're going to put you in Utpal Dutta's group, which is what they did. But before I did that, I got the chance to play Mrinmayee in Shrutajit Rai's Three Daughters, which was later released as Two Daughters, in Shamapti, which is the conclusion. That was the name of the film. Then 4 years, nothing. Finish your studies. I was in class 8 when I started. Nothing. Not accepted anything. And then I finished my higher secondary, and then I, of course, started acting. But apart from this Mrinal Sen film and another film that was written by Shrutajit Rai and done by his assistant, I found that I was constantly required to be flirting with the audience. And it was not fun. I mean, when I did Professor Mamlok with Utpal Dutt, I was again in a trance. It was wonderful, and everyone said I was very good. But then when the moment I started acting in these mainstream films, then I found that it was more important how I looked. My profile was not good, my nose was a problem, my walk was a problem, my smile was a problem. Everything seemed to be a problem, and all I had to do was stand in front of the mirror and see how I looked best. That's a very bad thing to happen to you, you know. For an actor, that's a terrible thing to happen, because then you forget everything else except that. And anyway, I had decided to be an actor, so in the beginning I didn't get any roles, but then I got, and then the two or three films were hits, and then suddenly I was a star, you know, before I knew it. And then I was acting in such terrible films. We didn't have the kind of choice that they have now. You know, it was mostly, it's true. I mean, we were mostly, you know, being coy and running around trees and things. The only films that I enjoyed were the comedies. Because at least you didn't have to be that coy. Or you were being coy in a funny way. Whatever. Then I was also acting in Bombay, where I felt completely like an imbecile most of the time because I couldn't speak the language. I felt that I couldn't even act, you know. I was suddenly all frozen, I who had loved acting so much. And then while waiting one day, either for a co-actor to turn up in a Bombay studio or for the lighting to be completed, I said, am I going to be doing this all my life, this mindless stuff all my life? And there was a resounding no in my head, because I had been a Film Society child. I'd really been brought up on world cinema. My parents were both founder members of the Calcutta Film Society along with Shrutajit Rai. And really, when we were about 10, 11, we were sitting in my parents' house in the balcony with an 8mm projector that was projecting Battleship Potemkin and, you know, the Passion of Joan of Arc and, you know, Ivan the Terrible and all of those things. So that's what we'd been brought up on. And then later on, more and more and more. Lots of things we couldn't understand, but still. So this was not my kind of cinema. I didn't know if I, where I would find my kind of cinema, actually, in order to be an actress and have a career. So I said, let me do something else. I used to be quite good at writing in school. So I said, let me try and write a short story. And this short story started becoming longer and longer and longer and more visual, until one day I found, caught myself writing Dissolve. I said, how could? And then I realized it was turning into a screenplay. So I said, okay, never mind, let it become what it wants to, and took the help of a friend and initially, and wrote out a screenplay which became 36 Chowringhi Lane. Why, at the beginning of my career, I chose an old woman, an Anglo-Indian of a minority community, I don't know, but I found that all my life I'd been attracted to marginalized characters. You know, this I found very strange. In school also, we had been taught by Anglo-Indian ladies, and I had seen how they were treated. You know, after the British left, I think that was the greatest tragedy for them, the end of the British Raj. And what happened after that was that they, you know, they weren't accepted by the Indians because they always wanted to go home. And also, they weren't accepted by the British because these were the, you know, born of the illegitimate children most of the time that they had left behind and all that, which I have right in the beginning, you know, of 36 Chowringhi Lane, if any of you have seen it, where, yeah, you have, great. Where, you know, all these people were going away. They were going to Australia, they were going away to Canada, New Zealand, all these places. They were all going and leaving their aunts and their old parents behind. And I went to many of those houses and I saw the poor conditions that they lived in. You know, it was quite a revelation. They were wonderful. They would give us pudding or whatever they had left over when my assistant and I were actually going around down Elliot Road and so on and looking for these Anglo-Indians. We just go into their homes, actually. And then they gave us their furniture and everything else on loan. No money. Nothing. It was a different world then. And if you want to know a little about Anglo-Indians, we could perhaps show a little bit, no?
Yeah, sure.
What used to happen then and how they were treated. They were not treated well. One person, a friend of mine who had married an Anglo-Indian, told me, you know, I'm very ashamed to say what my wife is. I keep saying she's Maharashtrian, but actually she's Anglo-Indian. I said, you're nuts. But this is a... So this is where... Just let me tell you, this is where Ms. Violet Stoneham, who is the protagonist of the film, has come to visit her brother, Eddie, at the old people's home. And it's Christmas Day, Christmas Eve.
Look, Eddie, there's a card for you from Kenneth. Eddie, I said there was a card for you from Kenneth.
Who's Kenneth?
Oh, Eddie, really now. Kenneth, your son Kenny. He's writing to you from Hong Kong, from his ship, and he wishes you a very...
Oh, Kenny. Kenny went away. Came a ship, he went away.
Yes. Well, he's remembering you now, and he wishes you a very happy...
I went away, Violet.
I don't know, Eddie. They all went away. Kenny, Rosemary. What are you thinking of doing now?
I've accepted Cedric. We're getting married and going away to Australia. He's got a job voucher.
But you never loved him.
I do now.
Oh, my dear. You mustn't marry like this on the rebound, you know. There's no hurry after all.
Isn't there? Cedric's in a hurry. He's got to be in Australia within 6 weeks.
Surely you could follow him later if necessary. Take your time. Think about it. Stay back for a while.
Doing what?
What about that job you applied for? Didn't you go for the interview?
There wasn't any interview. They deeply regretted that they were unable to accommodate me at the moment. And should there be any suitable vacancy in the future, they would kindly remember me. Sincerely yours.
I could speak to Mrs. Ainsley, of course. If there is any opening in the school...
No! You think I want to come back to a lonely old room when I'm 60 years old? You think I want a pile of homework to keep me company in the evenings? You think I want to land up in an old people's home like Uncle Eddie? That's where you'll end up in 10 years' time, make no mistake.
One other commonality between Konkona and me is that her film is also set in a place which belongs to, well, belonged to Anglo-Indians, was created for Anglo-Indians. So we've come full circle.
In fact, one of the things that I also is really interesting in your film, Konkona, is that you're also dealing with somebody who's outside.
Yeah.
I mean, the whole film actually looks at that. So it's. I mean, I'm sure it wasn't meant to have parallels, but it's really interesting to actually be talking now and find...
No, there are several parallels, actually. Yes. They're very different films, but there are several parallels between the two films. I'm thrilled about it. I'm very happy. We used to watch 36 so much as kids. I have, like, every dialogue memorized. I just watching it, it's like being back in my childhood, you know. I used to watch it again and again, like, every day, every so often we would watch it.
This film is also like being in your childhood, Death in the Ganj.
Yeah, and Death in the Ganj also, I think, is for me in a way just trying to recreate, you know, my childhood, my parents' imagined youth. And I remember when I was, I think when I was 4 years old or something, I remember mom waking me up one day early in the morning at about 4 in the morning saying, Otto, we have to go to McCluskey Ganj. Get up, we have to go to McCluskey Ganj. And I got up immediately. And so McCluskey Ganj still kind of, you know, is so evocative and so magical for me. Because I feel like McCluskey Ganj is like a special place. And I haven't been there, like, since the time I was 6 or 7 is the last time I was there. And the next time I went back was about 30 years later when I went back to do my location recce. So bizarre. But yeah, that's also about Anglo-Indians. It's not about Anglo-Indians, but that's about a family that travels to McCluskey Ganj, which is of course an Anglo-Indian town. But I think my film is more about Shutu, and it's just that the backdrop and the context is this little town, which I can tell you more about, but I don't know if it's relevant. But Shutu is a character in my film who's about 23 and who was once probably a bright and brilliant boy, but has been dealing with all kinds of things of late and is struggling to kind of, you know, struggling to keep up appearances or to maintain status quo and, you know, to convince himself and everybody else that he's fine. So for me, in a sense, that McCluskey Ganj And the Anglo-Indian community, it's almost like another parallel where, you know, it's like how the Anglo-Indian community was thrust upon McCluskeyganj really, because in 1933, Mr. E.T. McCluskey took some land from Ratu Maharaj in Bihar and founded this Anglo-Indian town. He invited 300 families and he founded this Anglo-Indian town, which flourished briefly. And then by the, after independence, a lot of people left, as you said. And I think in the 70s and 80s, it was really in a state of decay. And it was like the end of an era, which is why my film is also set in 1979, because it feels like the end of something. And much like the way that the Anglo-Indian community felt, you know, alienated or were marginalized from the mainland of India, the mainstream community of India, Shutu himself is like an outsider to his own milieu, his family members and, you know, people he's close to. He is a bit of an outsider himself. So I was just interested in speaking about people whom we often overlook and who don't have such a strong voice and who find it hard to speak for themselves. There are people, you know, who find it hard to speak for themselves, and I think I'm also a little bit like that in many ways. And in many ways I'm not, because, you know, I'm in a profession which is more public and I'm much older, and in many ways I've learned to deal with those kinds of things. But I remember that kind of a feeling from my childhood, and I think many people have that feeling. And there are times when we go through those kind of emotions where, you know, you are overlooked because you are not loud enough saying, look at me, this is my problem, this is my problem. And so many other people are doing it so loudly.
I think we all have a, we all have a Shutu in us, I think. I mean, we've all had to struggle with that at some stage in our lives, you know, when we've had to overcome that.
And I think that, I don't know, I don't want to give the story away, but I think that, you know, given a chance, many people can overcome that as well.
And I think all filmmakers or all most creative people have a space inside themselves where they are very alone. I remember telling my father, he used to, when I was about 14, 15, come out to our parties. We were never asked to stay indoors. And I said, I don't want to go. Why? I don't know what to say to people. So he said, I'll teach you a trick. Most people love talking about themselves. Just ask questions.
I was wondering, should we look at perhaps two clips? One is the, you know, the, from 36 Choringi Lane, when she's, the clip we have about her. Yeah? And then one from Dead in the Gunj. And it would be nice to see back-to-back,
actually.
Yeah, and
how similar they are, actually, in a way.
So can
this
we
is,
do that?
But we should tell them what it
is.
So it's Miss Tonam, whom you've just seen, Jennifer. She has baked a cake for Christmas. Everyone knows about it. Well, she's baked a cake for them, and they've told her a lie because actually they're going to have a party at home, but they don't want, you know, this old woman who's going to be a fish out of water. So they've told her that we've gone out, you know, etc., etc. And she's thinking how happy they'll be when they come back and find this surprise cake. So she's going to take the cake there.
Nice surprise it'll be for them when they come back and find it in their flat day after tomorrow.
It's been a hard day's night, fantastic. A real antique piece.
Yeah. An original Thorin is the 45th piece ever manufactured.
This is a clip from Death in the Ganj where this is Shutu, and Shutu, I'm giving away a little bit of the plot, but I think it doesn't matter. And they've been looking for somebody who's been missing, and he falls into this
animal trap,
this ditch kind of a thing.
Shutu bhaiya! Shutu bhaiya! Shutu bhaiya!
Maniya!
Maniya! Haan! Maniya, yahan pe! Kahan?
Yahan pe!
Shutu bhaiya!
Niche!
Niche, idhar gadde mein! Are! आपको सब लोग ढूंढ रहा है और आप ही यहाँ गिरे पड़े हैं। चलिए विक्रम भैया को मिल गया तानी। चलिए
seeing them back to back, it's I wanted to actually connect this to the other film we were chatting about, 15 Park Avenue, where you're also looking at somebody who doesn't have a place socially. So I was wondering if we could talk a little bit about why that film and
15 Park Avenue.
Unless you want to talk about something else first.
No, okay. Not at all. 15 Park Avenue is also about a person who's marginalized. Many of my films have that. You know, as we were discussing the other day, a lot of people think of me as some kind of feminist messiah, you know, which I'm not really. I mean, feminism for me is very, very strongly a part of humanism, general concern and love for human beings. 15 Park Avenue is very much a film about the nature of reality. Yeah, because, you know, I have somebody who's very closely related to me. And I found once that she was saying something. She was saying that my sister's nanny had hit one of the children. And so the nanny was confronted. And the nanny said, no, of course I haven't. You know, she says these things. So she said, no, but I saw her. I saw her hit the child. And then suddenly it struck me that she has a different reality that she's living in, because she is schizophrenic. Yeah, she has this condition, schizophrenia. And, you know, it is like telling me that, no, of course you didn't come to M-Cubed and talk to these people. You're just imagining it. And, you know, this thing struck me very, very strongly, because as it is, you know, whatever we perceive, I mean, I, you, she, you know, him, whatever. All of us, whatever we see, our perceptions are just slightly different from each other's. But in the case of a person who has schizophrenia, it is so wildly divergent that it is very difficult to reconcile the two realities. So much so that finally it becomes a kind of, dictatorship of the majority. The reality of the majority is thrust on the reality of the marginalized person. So this is what I was trying to say in 15 Park Avenue, where I don't think I could have been able to make it without somebody like Kokona. It would have not been possible because I think she captured, and a lot of psychiatric associations have screened the film, and they've told me that the schizophrenic condition has been portrayed by her in a way that they never imagined could have been done by somebody who's not schizophrenic. So you want to show that? It is really about the nature of reality. And I just want to tell you that it's also, interestingly, you'll find an interesting sound design here. The teacher, the half-sister, her half-sister, played by Shabana, is a professor who teaches quantum physics in college. And quantum physics is also, very much about the nature of reality. You have wavicles of probability. Now, what the hell is that? So, this is interesting because on the one hand, you have that. On the other hand, you have this other person's reality, which you're not being able to accept. Well, I think this will illustrate more what I'm trying to say.
Om Agni Swaha, Om Soma Bhyam Swaha, Om Agni Soma Bhyam Swaha, Om Vishwavedyo Devi Swaha, Om Dhanantari Swaha.
This equation was first discovered by Erwin Schrödinger, the Austrian physicist, in 1926, and is considered like a milestone in the history of human thought. Huh?
Born! Born!
Conceptual implications are, extremely contrary to our intuition, a microparticle, like let's say an electron, can display wave-like properties depending on how you observe it. But before I go into more mathematical detail, what I want to do is to make you feel the sheer excitement of the study of quantum mechanics, the physics of the atomic and subatomic world, which is based on Schrödinger's
theory,
which replaced Newton's laws. An important area of research currently is about unifying Einstein's theory of relativity with quantum mechanics, so that all forces of nature, gravitational, electromagnetic, weak and strong, can be combined under a single unified theory in order to go beyond Einstein's theory. You know that quantum mechanics is much more than just a theory.
Kitna doctor, kitni dawai,
completely new way of
thinking
about
it.
Where, probably,
humre gaon ki ladki ka kissa bataya raha na.
It implies major changes in some of the most cherished concepts.
Ab dekho, shaadi karke baal bachcha leke kaisa maje se reh rahi hai. Theek ho jayega sab.
देखिए दीदी, पीटी ने सारा बर्तन धो दिया, आपका सल्या की नौकरी गई।
गुड गर्ल, हाउ वाज योर डे स्वीटी? व्हाट डिड यू डू एट द डे केयर सेंटर? व्हाट डिड यू डू एट द डे केयर सेंटर?
जी, आई डिडंट गो।
डिडंट गो? व्हाई?
तबीयत ठीक नहीं था इसका आज।
क्या हुआ?
देयर वाज अ मैन हु केम एंड बीट मी।
Beat you?
There was no time.
तुमने हाथ उठाया मीठी पे फिर?
हमने? Not her. There was this man who came, he was a witch, and first there was a wedding, and but the we didn't have a veil, and then he had a broom, and he kept beating me. I don't know why. And mommy was also there, but
छोड़िए उसका बात.
She also didn't see.
दीदी, गीजर ऑन कर दे.
He kept beating me.
नहाते ही निकलना है मुझे. और चाय मेरे कमरे में ही दे देना.
God, I'll never get this done.
Didi?
Yeah?
Didi, I have to talk to you about something.
What is it? And why aren't you in bed? You know what time it is?
No, it's very urgent. I need to draw some money.
What money?
My money. The money I earned from my job.
Mithi, don't start on this now, please.
But Didi, I have money in the bank, Didi. The bank of Jojo and I have an account. The Bank of Baroda. The money earned when he was Prime Minister.
Prime Minister? He was Prime Minister?
Not Prime Minister of the country, Prime Minister of Shikagai.
What's that? Mithi, Shikagai is a herb.
It's a name of the company where Jojo was working in Baghdad. He was the president there. And I'm the editor of Illustrated Weekly. And all our money's in the Bank of Baroda in Bangalore.
Mithi, will you just go to bed? Charu, kahan tum?
Didi, you can't call Charu. Charu is against me.
Mithi, you're always imagining everyone's against you.
No, that's what I came to tell you. That's why I need to take out the money from Grinless.
Make up your mind, Mithi. You just said Bank of Baroda.
I'm in the branch, the Grinless branch.
I have to go over to Park Avenue. I can't stay with Charu anymore.
Why? What has she done now?
But Didi, I told you now this afternoon. Charu got someone to come and beat me up. And they do it when you're not there. And even Ma didn't say anything. Actually, they both hate Saddam. And they're both working for Bush because Jojo's in Baghdad and Saddam's helping us and they don't like Jojo.
Mithi, will you stop making things up? Just go to bed and let me finish my article in peace, please. Saddam Bush, God.
But I'm not making it up, Didi. Charu sent someone to beat me up today. I don't know why no one ever believes what I'm saying. How would you like it if I told you you're not a professor and you're only imagining it?
Not now.
Will you tell us a little bit about how you arrived at that character? How?
So like my mother said, we know someone very closely in the family who has schizophrenia. So I, in a way, it was like I was preparing for this role all my life. I never knew that I'd have to play this, but when I had to, then in many ways it was so easy and it was also very liberating because we didn't have to worry about, you know, hair, makeup too much. And it's okay if I forgot my line in between because she could just look vague and talk about something else. And then, you know, it was... Also very well written. It's so nice to work with Ma because often one gets to, you know, see an idea through from the time that, you know, it's a thought in your head. Then, you know, we are going somewhere in the car and then she starts telling me and as she's talking, she's developing it more. Then you hear another version later when she's telling somebody else on the phone, you can hear that. And then, you know, she writes different drafts. So one often has read, you know, many versions of the same work and seen how it's developing also, which is, I think, even unconsciously or intuitively, a great learning.
No, but I remember, if I may just interject, yes. One of the things that I remember telling her, and as she said, she's seen this person from up very close. One of the things that happens is because the person is living in another world of her own, therefore when you ask questions, there's a time lag before he or she answers, you know. He has to, and come back to your world. She has to enter your reality. So that time lag is there, which Konkona captured beautifully. And I also have to tell you about the choices she made, interestingly, because at that time she was supposed to act in Meera Nair's film Namesake in Tabu's role. And Meera was calling me up. You know, Meera had certain dates, and then, you know, those dates, she said, are yours graven in stone? I said, yes, you know, we're all ready. I mean, these guys are here, they're doing acting workshops. And
it's a very small budget film, so you can't.
It's a very small budget film. I mean, I see, that's a choice that I've made. I have to make small budget films, otherwise, I can't make the kind of films I want. The moment I have big stars in it, not like Shabana or Lilette or whatever, you know, then it becomes a different ball game. I can't do it. And then, so Konkona was now faced with the choice of acting in a Meera Nair's film, which was shown all over internationally, and acting in this little film. And she went into the bathroom, I remember.
I don't remember.
I remember. And she came out all red. And she said, I've had a good cry and I've made my decision. I'm acting in this film. I said, you don't have to do it because I'm your mother. She said, no, not because you're my mother. I want to do this film. This is the choice she made.
Oh my God. You know, I remember that.
This is the choice she made. All of us, Shabana, Rahul, all these people were saying, can't you do something? Can't you shift the dates a little? Because all of us, including me, wanted her to act in Meera's film. But there was nothing we could do. And she then made this choice.
It was very important to tell this story. And I feel so emotional, actually, because I know the person, and to have gone through this with my mother directing it, because I knew that this would have been a special experience. And you know what? I love Tabu. And Tabu did such a great job.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, this is not a comparison between you and Tabu, but the fact that she made this choice.
One never gets an opportunity to do these kinds of films and to do these kinds of roles. One doesn't get an opportunity. Who creates these kinds of worlds for you? And, you know, it's so well fleshed out, the roles are. You get to really explore what you want to do on your own. Like, you know, little things like, remember that thing, you know, like hiding my hands inside my sleeves.
She had sleeves in winter up too, and she pulled them up like this. And she was one of the mannerisms that, this for this film, as Shabana said, wo character ka jo essence hai, wo ek ghont peeli. And after that, you know, I was scared to give her any instructions. Really scared. Mm-hmm. Because I didn't want to interrupt this thing that she had entered. And I don't know when she had entered it and what her preparation was. With Konkona, preparations are very rarely seen on the exterior. I don't know. She must be having some kind of preparation.
Yeah, but I also am not aware.
That's what I'm saying. She's a natural as her workshop director, and I'm not here to praise my daughter. I'm just a director talking about an actress, okay? as my workshop director says, dogs bark, cats mew, Konkona acts.
That's very kind of them. She's my mom. Forgive her, she's my mom.
That's unfair. I am a director. This is the director speaking. No, shut up. That's a mom.
I told her and aside in Bengali, I'm trying to tell her, Beshi Bolo. Shut up.
No. I'm simply saying that, for this role, one of the things that she did, I remember, I don't know how much she remembers, I do remember. It was winter and we were in Bhutan. And it was winter in Bhutan, December. And, all of us were constantly using moisturizers and things, but not Konkona. I said, your lips are, her lips were chapped. I said, how do you do this? Her lips were completely chapped because at one stage I told her, Meethi, your character, she doesn't have a sense of personal hygiene. That's all I'd said, no more. She let her lips crack. And then she used to put powder so that the white cracks showed. This she did all by herself. And I said, her lips are looking so swollen and cracked. And, it was so meaty that, as I said, I didn't dare to tell her what to do ever. for this character, not for all characters.
I would put it another way. I would say that, you know, she really gave me the freedom to do with it what I would. Because both of us have had the reference of this real person, yes, who we are very close to.
And we went to a doctor.
And we went and spoke to doctors as well. So in that sense, you know, one really had so much freedom to explore that. And I also, and even though we had acting workshops and we did readings for that as well, with the other actors, with just you and me sometimes, we used to do these rehearsals and script reading sessions and things like that. But I also was not very aware of what exactly has to be, you know, it's more of an intuitive process. So it's not
I think
like
what
I
also helped was the look test. You know, where she, I think it probably helped, she did a makeup test to try and look like me. And as you know, that most actors in the process of doing their makeup, you know, that is one of the ways of slipping into a character. So I think that probably helped a little.
Yeah, you had actually mentioned that to me when you said that, you know, some people like to go from the outside in.
Yeah.
For Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, I remember that because, you know, it's over 1.5 days or 2 days or something. So whenever I would wear that yellow sari and those heels and, you know, that Mangalsutra, that Tali, they call it, and have that baby, then I used to feel like now I'm Mrs. Iyer back in the bus. Because you're just moving, outside to in.
Yeah, there are actors who move from the exterior to inwards, and there are actors who move from inside outwards, and both
work, and one sometimes has to do different things with different directors, because directors often set the tone of how things are going to be. So sometimes you have to adapt to, you know, different ways of working.
So shall we watch a little bit of Mr. and Mrs. Iyer and move on to, since you've given that beautiful segue,
and then we will talk about how we prepared for it.
Yeah.
No, and also because the other thing that I would like us to have a little bit of time to talk about, the other thing that keeps coming back and something that has been of concern to you obviously is the breakdown of harmony, is the breakdown of communal harmony and the kind of divisiveness that is happening. So maybe we can move into talking about
that. I just want to say for this role, when I was writing it, as Konkana says, I used to work on a desktop computer at that time, and that was in her bedroom, So she had a desk and it was over there because she also used to work there. So when I used to work late into the night, and Konkana used to read late into the night, so I often read drafts of the screenplay out to her, and then she used to discuss who we should take, whether we should just take one of the Reddy sisters and so on and so on. And
cast.
One day, casting of Meenakshi, who are you going to take? I said, I really don't know. And then one day I looked at her as I was reading, I glanced at her and I found her emoting unconsciously.
Embarrassing, so embarrassing.
Why am I looking outside? Why am I looking outside, you know? And when I told her, she said, no, I can't do it. I can't speak in that accent. I said, of course you can. And then what we did was, we used to talk in that accent. We would always talk in that accent, you know, between ourselves.
Except that she can still do it. I can't.
You can, you can.
I can't anymore.
You can.
But how she convinced me, you know, because first I said, no, I'm doing my MA now in Delhi. I can't do all this. And then she was very smart because she said, no, I need an assistant to do some research. So can you just go to Chennai and, for some time and just find out about the, you know, Shaivites and the Vaishnavites and who wears what and what the children's names could be and what kind of customs and things they had. So she sent me. And then I went to Chennai and you know, we had wonderful family friends who took care of us. And, you know, I had to find out all these things and, you know, met a lot of people from that community and went to temples and hung out with the mamis over there, what they call, and you know, so what happened is at the end of a week or whatever that time was,
and you had to find out the Tamil words for what, how Meenakshi speaks,
some
to her.
Dialogues I had to translate, some dialogues I had to translate, and Samira's father actually played my father in that film.
That's
and
right.
was so
yes.
helpful
yes.
So helpful, Viji uncle.
Viji played that role.
Yeah.
And you know, she came back and told me the name that I had chosen for the child was Murugan. She comes back and tells me, Mama, you can't use Murugan. Murugan is a lower caste. And she's written down all the names of all the possible Iyer names. And then I chose Santanam. But you know, I knew that this would
That was the hook.
And Condor and
the ME turned out to be so bad because, firstly, it was very ugly, the building, which is, you know, a deterrent. And also ugly and then, you know, like, anyway. And then we were doing the same things again and again, which I did in my A-levels and then we did it in college. And maybe they were doing it at a higher level, but it didn't feel like it. They used to make us read the poems aloud in class. And one day the teacher asked us the difference between a simile and a metaphor, which we had done in class 7. So then I said, forget it, I'll go and do Mrs. Iyer.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then she, you know, so she can really push herself and therefore also, she pushes herself, of course, too much, like how she's hurt her knee now. And then she pushes me also, you know, because I'm quite happy to, you know, sit
she
in a corner.
She was not going to be an actor.
I never wanted to be an actor.
You know what she wanted to be? She wanted to be a journalist and editor because I was an editor of a magazine at that time and she used to go to my office and she used to sit at the desk and then she used to pretend to be an editor when she was quite old. Huh? I mean, she was then going, just started going to college and things. So I said, if you want to be an editor, you can't just be an editor. You have to go through the process. So are you aware that you'll be, you know, pushing yourself and doing a lot of work and writing these articles that you've given your lifeblood for, and the editor will just put a line through it because the editor will say, no, you see, the publisher says you can't get such and such person angry, so they'll just put a line through your work. So you want to be that? You want to be an editor? Okay, become an actor, become famous, and then they'll just take you as an editor, don't worry.
That never happened.
And I had to push her to be an actor, and she says, you're just pushing me to an actor because you're an actor. I said, because I know you're very good. No, she wouldn't listen. Oh, it's only after she got the national award, she said, that's why everyone is saying that I must be good.
Then I might as well, yeah. And then she would keep talking in that accent all the time. It was so embarrassing. She would keep talking like that. She'd keep saying, see? And then we'd be in the car going to do some shopping or running some errand, and then she's also talking like this, I'm also talking like this. So it was great because I got over my inhibition and, you know, I was able to. But see, like, she can still do it and I forgot.
No, but she told me, she said, you know, I want to say the word toro.
Taro.
So I said, but where will you put it? She said, you know, when you're saying my father is an endocrinologist, my grandfather-in-law, I can say he's very thorough. I said, okay, put it in. And she got all that. You know how she said physics and all that. She got those lovely accents. Very nicely she got.
Sorry.
No, and also actually in the context of Hindi film, which is often just made fun of the accent. Right, it was so delightful to actually see the accent, not actually just spoken as an accent, you know.
We got a lot of proposals for her. From Chennai. Actually,
not
marriage proposals. Yeah.
Oh, I thought acting.
No,
was.
No, marriage proposals. For you, really?
I don't remember.
Yeah, I knew it. It was very fun. Chal, sorry.
Oh, yeah. No, not at all.
Listen, can you manage by yourself for the rest of the way?
Why? What happened?
Well, curfew's been declared. Communal rights are broken out. Apparently some Hindu extremists are on the lookout for Muslims. They're killing them.
But...
My name is Jahangir Chaudhary. Raja is just my pet name. I'm a Muslim. I have to go. Besides, I don't want to endanger anybody on this bus.
But I thought you're a Bengali.
I am. But I'm also a Muslim. And this is a primarily Hindu locality. Now do you see why I have to go?
Adarama. Un guru to jalate.
What's the matter? Are you all right?
Please, don't touch me.
Hey, don't open it! Hey! 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 that idiot!
नाम बोल, सुना नहीं क्या? नाम बोल।
सोहेल।
सोहेल क्या? सोहेल क्या? बाप का नाम बता भैंचोत।
सोहेल राय, सना समीर राय।
पैंट खोल, पैंट खोल।
अबे पैंट खोल साला।
हम सगळे हिंदू आहोत इथे, हम सब हिंदू आहे, यहाँ सब हिंदू हैं, सब हिंदू हैं यहाँ।
नो, नॉट ऑल, नॉट देम, दे मुस्लिम्स, द ओल्ड मैन एंड हिज वाइफ मुस्लिम्स।
आपका शुभ नाम?
इकबाल।
ये तो हिंदू का नाम भी हो सकता है, इकबाल क्या?
इकबाल अहमद खान।
देखा, हिंदू बन रहा था साला, हरामी। पूरा का पूरा खानदान का नाम मिटा के रख देंगे। चलो उठ, बस बकवास बंद, चल पीछे हट, पीछे हट।
आइए इकबाल साहब, थोड़ा बाहर आइए, कुछ बातचीत करना है।
मगर हमें तो कलकत्ता जाना है।
घबरा क्यों रहे हो? ये सबके सामने नहीं, अकेले में कुछ पूछताछ करना है। चलो आओ, चल आगे चल।
नाजमा, मेरे दांत।
जी, ये लीजिए। चश्मे भी चाहिए ना आपको? ये लीजिए। वो इनकी तबीयत जरा खराब रहती है आजकल, ठंड है ना, ये दवाई।
अरे घबराओ नहीं, ये जहाँ जा रहे हैं ना, वहाँ ये सब का कौनो दरकार नहीं। चल।
नो 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 प्लीज प्लीज प्लीज।
ले जा, ए चुप।
कहाँ ले जा रहे हो आप इनको?
अरे तुम बैठो ना। अरे ए, चलो आगे, चलो आगे। ये काफी, ले चल साली, चल, ले चल, ले चल साली को, चल, ले जा।
अरे
जस्ट होल्ड हिम।
क्या है?
मिस्टर एंड मिसेस अय्यर, सुब्रमण्यम अय्यर, एंड दैट्स अ सन संतान।
कैसे करूं
इस्तेमाल हर सीने बशर में निहार तेरा रूप है
before the 2002. It was strange because we finished the shooting on the 28th of February, which was the day that Godhra happened. Because a lot of people have told me and they thought that it was based on the Gujarat riots because it was released in 2002, but it wasn't, you know. And when Godhra happened, all of us felt a kind of chill, all the unit members, because it was almost like this was clairvoyant, you know. I mean, it was almost like we'd brought this on. It was horrible. We all felt terrible. We felt a kind of constriction inside after we heard about Godhra. But this was done because, you know, of so many riots going on all over the place. The Bombay riots had happened before, some time before, but it had happened, you know. And actually this film was not supposed to be about Hindu Muslim initially. It was supposed to be a love story set inside a bus for a journey, because I had felt that a physical journey can be a wonderful metaphor for an inward journey. You know, a journey is a wonderful place for you to experience new things, especially when you're among a lot of people. And, you know, you also discover yourself. You make a journey within yourself, which is what happens to Meenakshi. but, you know, the thing is that ever since 1992, with the demolition of the Babri Masjid, something had happened. My father and I kept talking about it, and we kept saying it won't really be demolished. India is a secular country. It can't possibly be. And then it did happen. When it did happen, you know, it was like a revelation. And ever since then, I was then editor of a magazine, as I just told you. And I think at least 75% to 80% of my editorials have been on communal harmony or, you know, about communal fighting and so on, and talking about that. And I'm still doing that to this day. We did it, not in my name, just day before yesterday. The thing is, you know, you don't know what lurks inside you. And you don't know that, you know, you don't always know your own brand of politics until you're faced with it. And I think every human being, whether they realize it or not, they are political. The very act of voting is a political act. So I think what had happened is that as I wrote the story, these characters became Hindu, Muslim, etc., etc., and this whole thing emerged. It happens, it comes from somewhere inside, and that is the magic of creativity anyway, because, you know, you're not always aware of what is there inside you. Something hits you and you don't immediately think, oh, I'm going to make a film about this. You don't. You know, and then grows inside, it marinates inside, so to speak, and then sometime, somewhere it comes out. I think that's the way it happens most of the time. And now I find that many of my films have been speaking out against intolerance of the other. And you know, you saw that song there? That is a translation by Ramanujan of a Veera Saivite poem of the 10th century that speaks about Advaitavad, which is that there is no other. Everybody is you. Everybody is part of the Lord. So we have that. We have that in the two major religions of our country, Hinduism and Islam. It is not something that we have to import from outside. It is there in Sufism, love of everyone. It is there in Hinduism, in Advaitavad. But we have today a terrible climate where Hindu fundamentalists and Islamic fundamentalists and fundamentalists of all kinds, actually they don't have a religion, it is a religion in itself. And they are, you know, they're so divisive, they're dividing our society. And I think those voices are being heard because they're so strident. And the liberal and secular voices are not heard because we take it for granted that everybody else is going to think like us, but they don't. And it is very important for us all to actually speak out against it. And I find that I've been doing it in one film after another. I mean, not realizing it. Even in Arshinagar, which is my film called Arshinagar, translates as City of Mirrors. In that, it's a musical version of Romeo and Juliet, where Juliet is a Muslim and Romeo is Hindu. Zulekha and I forget the name ta ki chilo, Romit or something. Anyway, there too, I have used a Baul and Sufi songs because I feel that is the answer. Really, I feel that is the answer. And maybe we'll just show that and then we'll go on to something else. Yeah. It's just a small clip.
আমার ভেতর আমি কেতা খবর
বেগম সাহেব আপনি আমাদের বাঁচান বেগম সাহেব আপনার কাছে থাকতে দিন চারিদিকে দাঙ্গা আমার এই নাতনিটাকে নিয়ে কোথায় যাব আর হে আল্লাহ কোনো কোনো কি ছিল দরকার পাগল হয়ে গেছে সবাই এ নিচ্ছে ওর যান জানাম ভার চিনি যাদের তারাও আজান যান
ঠিক আছে चलो जब तक दंगा न मिटे थाको आमार काचे सुनो बारे दरवाजा बंद करो जाओ
जी जी
सुलेखा आमार दी के जाओ सचमुच प्यार करती हो तब्बू के कातिल से
आमार भेतर आमी केता खबर रख लेना আমার ভেতর আমি কেতা খবর রাখলি না আমার ভেতর আমি কেতা খবর রাখলি না
This is Zulekha's grandmother talking to her and she says you heard sachmuch pyar karti ho tabbu ke katil se tabbu is Tabriz in the film and this is Tybalt So Tybalt has been killed and Romeo has killed Tybalt, so she says that. And then we cut to this Baul woman, this is Parbati Das Baul, you know, and she does this and she's saying, Ami Ami Kore Badao, you keep saying I, me, myself. E Ami Keta Bolona, who is this I? You're so obsessed with this I and me and myself, who is this I? আমার ভেতর আমি কেতা খবর রাখলি না ইউ হ্যাভ নো ক্লু অফ দ্য আই ডিপ ইনসাইড ইউ সো দিস আই হু ইজ ডিপ ইনসাইড ইউ ইজ অ্যাট ওয়ান উইথ দি আদার নট অ্যাট ভ্যারিয়েন্স উইথ দি আদার দ্যাটস অল ইউ নো দিটস দ্য সেম থিং দ্যাট ওয়ান হ্যাজ বিন ট্রাইং টু সে
Okay. So we'll open it out if you have any questions or comments or anything else you'd like to ask at this moment. Yeah.
Sorry, just could you pass this so question? Yeah.
You said that all your films touch on intolerance and you've been doing this for so long. Well, so you know, it's been 30 years since 36 Chowring Lane, I think, or more than that, 35 years, and the intolerance is just growing. So, you know, where are we going?
I never claim that I've been able to change the world.
No, I know that. I know that. So, what can change?
I don't know. You know, a filmmaker or any creative person cannot say what the solution is. Can just hold up the problem. Well, I also have tried to say what the solution is. The solution is love. That's every time it's love. As an against violence, you know, that sort of thing. In the same film, I have a Sufi song where you know, you intercut with scenes of violence that are taking place. But what I'm saying is, not all my films have been about intolerance. It's also been about marginalized people, women being part of that marginalized group. Just as in Konkona's film, people say she's made a film with a man who's a protagonist. And I, most of my films have been about women who are protagonists. But I just told her the other day that actually Konkona's film is very much a feminist film, because she speaks out very strongly against the what is, you know, the male stereotype. Very strongly.
And how men could also be victims of patriarchy. But also I was just thinking that one of the ways, I also don't know at all, but I think that it's important, like, to you know, often we live in a bubble. Because we have ourselves and we have like-minded people around us.
Yeah.
And we just, it's like an echo chamber, and we're just talking to ourselves and protesting amongst ourselves. And so it's so important to engage with people outside of that bubble and to do it on a daily basis and to teach our children. I think that's the most important. And not to normalize. I mean, there's so much normalization of everyday sexism and everyday microaggressions, and in terms of, like, you know, whether it's communal or otherwise. You know, I think we normalize it a lot, and it's every time that I think it's important that we call it out and we at least talk about it.
Yeah, the only thing I'd like to add to that is that maybe it's important to also find ideas to combat, you know, this other side, so to speak, is saying beef ban and, you know, things that seem to excite a lot of people. Maybe we don't have ideas that excite
people. But you know what?
We don't have organization.
What we need to tell them, what we need to tell them is what Gandhi had said about beef ban. Actually,
but you know, these guys don't care for
Gandhi. They don't care for Gandhi. Yeah.
So, I just want to pick up on one point, and perhaps make it sure, because I think one of the things that your film does beautifully, right, and I think it's an important point that they made, and I just want to pull out, is that often we separate the large, obvious violence from the violence we practice in everyday life.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And that's the point you're actually making. When you're saying love, you're not saying like love some strange other, you're saying how do you practice that as an everyday living? And I do want to show that driving tip from your film,
sure.
Because I think she actually captures
that. Oh my God.
What she's saying right now about normalizing violence, you know, you see it. And you see the flip side.
Start at home.
Yeah.
Do you know which one?
Yeah.
Driving.
Yeah.
Isha always does.
Yeah.
Oh, he's wonderful.
So a younger cousin is being taught driving by his older cousin, both men.
Okay, now we'll take it a little ahead and then we'll reverse it on. Okay? Shudra Dada, come on. Yeah. Good. Good, good. Gentle on the clutch. Yes. To the left, okay. Relax. Okay? Start the car again. Okay. Check the rear view mirror. Check the rear view mirror. Done?
Yes.
Put the car in reverse. Is it in reverse? Now look in the rearview mirror and back the car. Come on. It's not in reverse. Do it again. Push it down. Hard. Push it hard. Back in 2. 10 in 2. 10 in 2. Shutu. 10 in 2. Shutu. Hand position. 10 in 2. Be glad that my dad's not teaching you. You know what he did when I made a mistake?
Baba.
Relax, Tani. That's how you learn. Now look in the rearview mirror and reverse the car. Gently and turn left. Yeah. Left, left, turn left. Left, 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 left. Now to the right. Right, 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 right. Shutu, right, Shutu, right. Damn it, Shutu! Get out of the car!
That's how most men teach you.
That's true.
Horrible.
Thank you so much
for talking to us. And just want to personally say that thank you for making the films that both of you are making. And you've consistently been a voice of, you know, the progressive voice from... please give them a I have followed your work, Konkana, since your first film, and I've loved you in every film. And Avunadi, of course, it's amazing to see watch your films. And I feel like, you know, from Ray to Rituporno to you and now Konkana, you've kind of formed a thread of this progressive ideology and point of view, and that's so important right now to you know, have in the world and have in India right now. And personally, it has affected me a lot that you are making these films. I want to ask you a couple of questions about the craft of filmmaking, because both of you come from acting. So I just want to know that when you made the transition from acting to direction, did you feel intimidated by the you know, the power that being a director gives you? And was it intimidating? How did you learn the craft, or was it on the job while you were being an actor? And the second question, part of that is, is there anything like a woman director, and is there a different perspective that women bring into filmmaking? These two
questions. Seniority, okay. No, well, I, as an actor, I was very observant. With me, it's a case of curiosity killed the cat. You know, so it's really killed me. I mean, it pushed me into filmmaking because I was always so curious. I mean, why is the trolley going from this side to this side in front of that side to that side, you know? And I used to suggest things. One of the things that I used to very much enjoy is to sit there and observe the lighting and the set design. And I would also say things, even at that age, you know, say things which were like, why are you taking against this flat wall background? You know, and one of the cameramen said to me, but you know, there is no other background here. Look at the color of the walls. Color of the wall is orange. The floor is orange. Everything is that very strange orange. So then I said, no, but you can hang a yellow sari behind, you know, over there. The sets run out. I said, cover it with a sari. These are the kind of things that I used to say. Sometimes I used to even write, you know, when the scene wasn't working, I used to write it. I did that as an actor. After I was accepted, one of the things I remember, this is very funny, I have to tell you. Okay, this is, I was doing in a comedy, I was doing something silly, you know, like this man was saying something, what will you call me after we are married? And he said, I will call you this, I will call you, and I kept saying with using my legs, I was doing that. So, and then he said, okay, I'll call you. And then, okay, you know, little bits. So, the director after the whole thing says, it was brilliant. I got you in a big close-up. So I said, but what about my legs? That's what I was doing with my legs. What about my legs? Another time, they said, oh, you know, some woman, my co-actress, she says something very cruel, and I'm ironing, and I have tears in my eyes, a big close-up, they're going to tears roll out. She said, that's been done to death. Why? I'm ironing, okay? So why don't I, you know, when I'm so surprised, I look at her and the clothes get burnt and then I suddenly notice. So I did that. They said, yeah, do that. Again, the director, big smile, big close-up. So I said, but what about the clothes that got burnt? So he said, oh, we'll do that. I said, you know, you're not going to get me if you want to. This, when I was little established, but not much. This was musical, this was an adaptation of Sound of Music in Bengali. So I said, you know, please take a shot of my hand right now. So they, thank God they did it. You know, these were actually learning processes which I hadn't realized. But another thing I have to say, that I wasn't scared of saying that I don't know. I told Ashok Mehta, I said, he asked me what lens, so I said, I don't know. I said, Ashok, I don't know anything about. He said, okay, can you tell me in one word the look that you want in 36 Cherungil in one word? They're very difficult. How to describe a film in one word? The look. I said, okay, you know, if a rose has been pressed for a very long time within a book, you take it out and you know how the colors have faded into pastels. That's the look I want. Okay. Then he said, I said, listen, I can't tell you what lenses and all. They show me. Achha, dekho, ye 28 hai. Achha, ab dekho, ye 16 hai. Ab dekho, ye 32 hai, etc. Ah, this one.
you know. Or I would say, Ashok, I don't know how to tell you this, but in the graveyard scene, I want Miss Tonam to be, you know, sharp and all that, everything else to be blurred. My assistant next to me says, you're talking about a telephoto lens. I said, then I am. Ashok said, never mind, you just tell me the pictures that you're seeing inside your head. It is my job to get it on the screen. So that was there. And because I was an actor, it was easy for me to write dialogue because I would mentally say them when I was writing them. And I think that, and then one learned on the job also. You learned not to be so upset at everything.
I mean the mistake.
She's Konkana Singh.
Yeah. I'm sorry. And also Meenakshi wanted to ask. No, I was saying that, you know, I was so unhappy on my first film because I just hated everything that was happening in the first, in that film. I was in between my second and third year of college. I'd done the film as a lark and I was very unhappy acting in it because I was, you know, studying English literature and feeling very like cool and snobbish, and I was doing a film which was not that interesting actually. But it was about a negative kind of a psychopathic teenager. And I was so unhappy with everything, with the dialogues, with the clothes she has to wear, the kinds of things she has to do, the way it was looking, that every day I would cry. And I thought I would never continue with this. But then eventually down the line, I think I developed a certain detachment which really helped me as an actor, where I would be able to just focus on myself and my work. Because, you know, the film set is such a chaotic place and it's so, you know, there's so many people, all important, doing their own thing. And to just find your place there peacefully and your focus, that's also a difficult thing to learn. And I think that that's an important thing to learn also even in life. So that sense of detachment, I think I had practiced to a certain extent, which really helped me in my films. But when it came to shooting Death in the Ganj, I think what helped there was that because it was from my childhood and my memory, and I had written it along with an associate, but I had basically conceived it. So I knew who these people were and what they would look like, you know. I knew who they were, like what they would say, how they would behave in another situation, because they constantly ask you questions when you're doing prep. They're constantly, how many chickens are there going to be in the backyard, you know? And I was like, four, maybe. No, but you know, so they keep asking all kinds of questions. So it really helps if you, for me, it really helped because I had created that world in any case. So I felt I was able to answer those questions. I was intimidated by the fact that I didn't have a lot of technical knowledge because I hadn't been to, like, you know, a film school or something. But Ma was very reassuring, and she had said that as long as you know what kind of visuals you want and you can describe that to your cinematographer. And therefore, my cinematographer, Shishare, was so good. We actually sat and went through every scene and drew out various things. He also draws very well, and he drew out several things, and we discussed it and watched films together. And of course, the technicians are also amazing to help you.
Yeah, technicians are. They're the best, most disciplined bunch of people in the world, a film crew. You know, people have asked me, oh, a female director, how did you do it? I said, no, because, you know, the moment they know that you know what you want, they're very good. You were saying something.
I have two questions.
Oh, sorry. A female director. You want to answer? Yeah. I think there's definitely a male gaze and a female gaze. For instance, I'll give you an example. A lot of the violence that takes place in Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, probably a male director would have shown it much more graphically. Whereas I wouldn't. I mean, I don't think a female would. As long as the necessary impact has been created. I saw you people, all of you gasping and, you know, being with them, you know. As long as that happens. As long as the message is clear, I don't. You know, little boys enjoy, for instance, tearing off wings of dragonflies and things. And I don't know, I'm sorry, apologies to the men who are different here, but I don't know if they quite get over it right till the end. If they do, good. If they don't, then they need to.
Also, I think that gender, you know, is learnt along the way. I have a 6-year-old boy now, and I can see that, you know, male, female is okay. It's your assigned at birth or not, and you can see, you know, there are other parts also. But I think it's something you learn along the way, how to be a boy and how to be a girl. And it's, you know, then there are different situations, you know, where, you know that somebody expects you to be a certain way and you can play up that part, you know. So I find in the real world, one has to kind of keep juggling, you know, these kind of different energies. And even with women, you know, how you interact with women is different from how you would interact with men or not. It depends. I was also going to say that... I lost the thread of what I was going to say right then. That how people perceive authority. Because, you know, a lot of the time I find women emulating an accepted form of authority, like being like men. You know, not in any other way, but just because they find it effective. You know, screaming, shouting, abusing. And it's how, it's because it's dependent not so much on us. I mean, if you're not going to listen to somebody who's doing a non-violent protest, down the line, who knows where that's going to go? You know? So it's so much is incumbent upon us and the audience.
You have to tackle it differently. For instance, here with your editor, this is not going to work, Rinadi. So I'll say something like, and I'm sure Coco does the same thing, is, yeah, okay. So just let's try it my way. And if we don't like it, we can always go back to your way. You know, instead of saying, no, my way is right. Yeah, you negotiate your space. Sorry.
Can you use a mic so they can hear also?
Yeah, hold it close. Yeah,
now I won't say. Aparna, you can answer what I ask you later. Because what I wanted to ask you was whether your films, I have seen most of them, but I want to have them. Like, you know how I have Ray's films and other
how
films.
Sweet.
No, so what's so sweet? Anyway, so I wanted to know whether... There are sets available there. Because in Bombay, sometimes this Bengali films subtitle, it does become difficult. So if you can, or someone knows, then I'll be very happy to.
Yeah, well, you can get in Bengal.
Amazon,
you can get them.
Uh-huh.
I'm sure
subtitled,
you can get...
Because
subtitled, usually. But you know, what we were going to show a clip from Poroma, because she was very keen. But the thing is that, you know, I don't even know if the negative exists, because there was a flood in Prasad Film Laboratories, and possibly the negative has been ruined, and whatever we have on DVD now is really bad, not digitally corrected. They weren't in those days, but we really to have them restored. Otherwise, there are many films of mine that are available on DVD, and I'm sure you can get them on Amazon.
Now a question for both, actually. Especially after while watching the clip of 15 Park Avenue. And you were talking about a person who's close to you both, who has been schizophrenic. A very old concern suddenly got triggered, and that is that when we are either writing scripts or when we are acting, or, you know, whatever, when we base things on marginalized people, different people, in one way, yes, we are trying to bring their stories in front of people. But on the other hand, I've always worried, am I exploiting them somewhere? Am I using them somewhere? You know, like, or when I see other people's films on autistic people or, you know, whatever has passed, I feel many times the balance is gone, which is not gone here. I'm not saying that. So have you ever felt that preparing for a role or whatever while writing, that this is too close to me, but I don't want to exploit this person. I know that person, he or she or whoever, too well, and it might come out. These sort of dilemmas, have you ever faced? Creative dilemmas.
Have you?
I was just thinking that, you know, the problem is that I was thinking from another side, because the problem is that we don't actually see differently abled people in films. It's as though they don't exist, or they don't occupy any space in society, which is why in your films, again and again, we see them in different kinds of roles.
Not only central roles. They're also there as completely side characters, you know. Because I remember one incident, you know, of a friend that we both know, Rita. She's a friend of mine. She was my beautician. Very kind woman, very kind, gentle person. She went to, during 15 Park Avenue, she went to this, not 15 Park Avenue, Paramita Ragdin, she went to the Spastic Society, the Institute of Cerebral Palsy in Kolkata. And she said, I can't take it. So I said, why can't you take it? There was this guy who was trying to write a letter to Madhuri Dixit on the computer using his tongue, because he couldn't use anything else, and asked me to carry, to somehow reach that letter. Now the thing is that she said, I can't bear it. She couldn't bear it because she got used to it. I think it's very important that we see them as part of the citizenry. That's one. And secondly, this film, 15 Park Avenue, for me was a tribute to this other person that we're talking about. It depends on your attitude to the person, to the disease, to whatever it is. And as I said, it was not only about that, it was also about the nature of reality, which was, to me, even more interesting. But, you know, I've never felt that I'm exploiting. Then in that sense, you can be exploiting anybody, a marginalized person, a lonely person, an old person, a little child. What about the films that are made on children, especially ad films, which are completely exploitative? You know, it's not like that. It's your attitude as a filmmaker or an actor. Thank you. It was my second film. It took a long time for me to get there. 5 years. I've been telling Konkona, please make your second film. Don't make my mistake. And I said the same thing. Well, when are you making your second film? I said, when I get something I really want to talk about. And then Poroma came along. You know, I had seen a friend of mine. I've said it many times and many places. I had gone to her son's, what we call rice ceremony, annaprashan, you know, where child has first time has rice. And she was there, she was a friend of ours, she was behaving with us the way, you know, oh, you remember that teacher in school, Acha, remember how she used, etc., and me laughing and joking. Then some elderly relative comes along and she, aunt, how are you? She goes and touches that person's feet. Then another young person comes along with her mother-in-law. You know, this is my daughter-in-law. Oh, how are you? And she's, you know, she's switching roles like this. And I said, where is this girl that I used to know in school? Where is she? She's good looking, very good athlete. She was the head girl. She was very good in studies, used to recite beautifully, write beautifully. Which of these is she? And that's how it came to my head. That I want a role, I want a film about a woman who actually has been so completely camouflaged in the societal roles that she plays out that you really don't know who she is. And it's her discovery. But it didn't come to me like that. It came to me more, it was a film that was very visually influenced in only one way by Girish Kasaravalli's Ghata Shraddham. Because when I saw that film and I saw this woman at the end with her hair shorn, this is the image of the archetypal adulteress. That's the image that came to my head. And that's the image that created Poroma, and I knew that I had to have that, and I wove the story so that she attempts suicide, cuts her vein, artery or whatever, and then she falls down and I talk to the doctors. She hurts the occipital area of her brain where she may have to have a surgery and therefore her hair is cut. All that logic came later. First it was the image and the image of the aunt. Later I was told about, you know, the woman in the attic. Lots of feminists asked me this. I said, you know, I hadn't read that book, strangely. She said, it doesn't matter, you don't have to read the book. It's now a part of racial memory. So I said, okay. But this one came from an aunt of mine, who of course didn't have a hair shorn, but she was there again in on the third floor, the terrace room. And we weren't allowed to go there. Much later, I heard from my mother that actually she had, once upon a time, she had had an illegitimate pregnancy, and then how all that was taken care of, etc., etc., and she was there. But of course, she wasn't mad. But you know, it could very much, these are the things that came into it. As far as the making of it goes, Ashok Mehta was there, and I made it, unfortunately, with two negatives, Hindi and Bengali, and that was a mistake. Should never have done the Hindi, because the Hindi was not good. But anyway, it took me a long time. I was much more concerned about everything having to be right. I was much more adamant about those things. Today, like we've talked about it many times, Konkona and I, when she told me, you know, this, I said, don't get too wedded to anything. The basic idea, yes, but you constantly have to think on your feet as a film director, because ultimately you have to keep making films. You know, you can't let a film become so expensive because you don't like this or you don't like that. I'll reshoot that, finally you don't get any films again given to you, which it happened to me after Parama. Then finally I had to prove my point by making Paramita Ragdin within 30 lakhs. You know, to say that yes, a film can be, I can make a film cheaply.
Now, just one last question. So you just said that your pieces are centered around the marginally deprived people. So if given a chance, how would you prioritize, like what would you prioritize between the two? Showcasing the issue, basically, or B, how to break the stereotypes which are surrounded by that issue. So,
see, for me, the issue.
Which is more important, the issue or the stereotype?
The individual. It's always the individual. Through the individual, through the process of exploring an individual, and an individual in a certain. Maybe sometimes in a certain predicament that is nationally or even internationally recognizable, you know. But what happens to the individual? How does it affect that individual? To me, that's much more always interesting, rather than the issue itself. Because for me, this is not a platform where I've come to preach.
Just a general one. As movie makers, why is it in your opinion, aren't there enough good cinema?
I don't know. I think that also, you know, what happens is because so many people view films differently, you know. There's so many corporates, so many suits now come into this whole situation. They view it more as a business and a product. There are, of course, then there are stars, which are another, they drive a lot of the money, they direct it in different places in a way, because of them the money moves. And then there are also, some artists and things, but what happens is people view it differently. And because a lot of the time we're chasing the money, what happens is that producers don't want to take risks. Many people don't want to take risks, so we keep making the same kind of film again and again. There's no real space for making different kind of films, or even experimental films. I mean, you have to be able to try out different kinds of things, be able to experiment, but that doesn't happen because they're so afraid to give a little money for something experimental, but they would rather give a lot of money to something that is tried and tested, which may or may not work. So it's so dependent on producers, I feel, and on audiences, because if audiences don't support alternative content, then how will they expect for it to be provided to them? But I don't know the answer.
Are doing better these days.
They are doing better, yes, apparently, these days. Every year there are four or five.
I don't know. But still, they are doing much better.
To an extent, because even if you get the funds, then the government might not approve. So,
but even if the government doesn't approve these films, I mean, most of them, barring a few, they still come out. They will still come out. Like Haramkhor actually had to go to the tribunal. Urta Punjab had to go to the tribunal. Lipstick had to go to the tribunal. Huh. So it skipped. It went through two layers and then to the tribunal and then. But they released. But the problem is that unless you have a big star, at least from what I can understand from my little space, yeah, is that unless you have a big star, you are not given money. Because that what dictates the budget of the film, not the story, not the you know, the nitty-gritties of production, but who is in your film. That's what dictates the amount of money you get, by and large. By and large.
Kamran, would you someday want to, I don't know, return the favor, slash, get even and maybe direct your mom?
Getting even. It's a lovely idea. It's a lovely idea. I'm going to think about it. How scary that'll be.
Have I done what?
Have you ever written something specifically for Kamran? I know you convinced her to be an actor, even though she didn't want.
Well, 15 Park. No, I didn't write it with Konkona in mind. But 15 Park Avenue, when I was writing it, I knew it had to be Konkona, definitely. But not every film of mine have I. You know, a lot of people say now, of course, that she's got Konkona, she will not cast any other actor. This is not true. I have cast Raima, and I have cast other people also, Ritupadna and so on. Well, you know, it's, well, if I know that Konkona is, it's a role that Konkona can play, and I know that, you know, she's not going to give me any grief about dates, Evo. it's so much easier to have Konkona.
Thank God. I'm so happy. So grateful. One question.
I don't know if I should dare say it because it's not a question, but just something I wanted to share for years. It's a scene that I've always felt that some of the greatest moments in cinema without words such. And there's a haunting song that you have in Paromita Rak Din, where this actress is sitting in this very grubby national dress, house coat, sitting with a tambura against a window and singing Hridaye Amar.
Oh my God.
And I just burst into tears. I don't know Bengali much. I just have an instinct from watching the movies. But I just burst into tears for the whole length of that song. And then I saw it like 10, 15 years later at NCP in some other setting. And again, I just howled like a dog. The first time I heard it, I had to really find out the meaning because I don't know why I was crying so much. Of course, you get the general mood, etc. But then it struck me because it was specifically a Radha Krishna song, then that there were so many layers to it.
Radha Krishna song?
Wasn't it?
No.
Hridaye Amar Prakashalo.
Hridaye Amar Prakashalo Ananta Akashi. It's really a more of devotional song of Tagore's.
Yeah.
My heart has opened itself out on this Hridaye Amar Prakashalo Ananta Akashi.
Doesn't she say that you're wearing this mala in the third
it's,
or fourth
it's
verse?
It's that you have, you appear to me in so many guises.
Yeah.
But it's not a Radha Krishna song. No, it's not a Radha Krishna song. But you know what? There is a chota sa history in this. That is, this other person that we're talking about, this schizophrenic person. Now, Mrinal Sen did this film called Mahaprithivi. There was Anusha Mazumdar was playing this girl who's supposed to be also have schizophrenia. And I suggested to him, I'm her sister-in-law, Bhabi, and we have some words, she's angry, etc. She throws things, she goes away. And I said to Mrinal Sen that, you know, I've seen this other woman that I'm close to, and she sometimes after all this, then she will be singing a song. And then suddenly it's another person, you know. And you suddenly realize what depths there are in a person like this. There's so much depth. And I suggested to him, he said yes, but he didn't use it. And then you do it, I must have stored it away somewhere. And then when it came to Paramita Rak Din, I used it.
It's heartbreaking. I saw it years later, still howl. And actually, that song is the reason I started to learn Bengali in a very lay person way, but it's so beautiful and haunting.
But it's, you know, it's what Konkona says is right. It depends on who you have in the film. You know, I've been directing films for 30 years or over 30 years, and still it's the same struggle to try and find funding. And I think I just keep doing it because I want to make my own kind of cinema, which I'd wanted right in the beginning. I still want that. And I'm nowhere near achieving any success in the area of funding.
Did you welcome
Jennifer in your mind? Not initially. I wanted a real Anglo-Indian act. She's brilliant. Yeah, she did it later. She used a North London dialect actually, initially an accent. But it was Utpal Dutt who said to me when I said that. He said, "Are you mad? For your main protagonist, you're going to use a non-actor? You're mad."
So I said, why, I can teach. He said, you can't. Don't even try. Take Jennifer. So I said, but I saw her in Junoon, straight backed and wonderful. Then when I told Jennifer, she said, you don't worry, I can think wrinkles, she said. Can we end there?
Yeah.
Thank you so very much for an absolutely wonderful evening and for all of you for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And this is the audience, for the audience.
Thank you, Junoon and Samina.
And
Kishan and Edgar.
Yes, and we want to thank Junoon. We want to thank Sanjana, Samira. You can hear me, no?
Yes. Ishan and Edgar.
Ishan and Edgar. And all of you who made this possible, and the audience.